The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
At that time, Jesus said to the crowds, "To what shall I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to their playmates. We played the flute for you. You did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not moan. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they said, 'He has a demon.' The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, 'Look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.' Yet wisdom is justified by her deeds." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated, and our text today is taken from Isaiah chapter 48, verses 17 to 19. Isaiah chapter 48, verses 17 to 19. Please open your Bibles. Isaiah chapter 48. So before I begin this homily, I just wanted to share with you that I think it was this evening, Paolo, we were talking about the Advent readings, and I was saying, you know, nothing really changes in the Advent readings if you listen very carefully. It's the same message. The whole of the Old Testament, in fact, can be divided into three parts: what we call before the exile, during the exile, and after the exile. And the message does not change. God is saying the same thing to us. Why? Why does God say the same thing to us? Any idea, Pearl? Why does God say the same thing to us? You can take your mask slightly down and say, why does God have to say the same thing to us again and again? Annalise, why does God say? Kyunki isme kya hai? Bhussa. Bhussa hai na? Huh? God has to again and again say the same thing to us. Yeah, but because he loves us, he says the same thing again and again. Nah? When somebody loves you, what do they say? Again and again and again and again. Nah? Because they love us. So, in the past chapters, if you notice in the prophet Isaiah, we have heard again and again of what happened to Babylon. Yeah, its final fate, how God finally says, "I will destroy Babylon." But the very idea of looking at the people of Babylon's fate now makes the prophet Isaiah turn and look at whose fate? The people of Israel. God only doesn't judge our enemies, he also judges us. And so you see that the prophet Isaiah in today's first reading turns the microscope, as it were, on Israel and says, now let's look at you. Yeah, we look at our neighbors and complain about them. We look at everybody else and judge them. And God says, let's turn the microscope, microscope. Huh? Microscope means all our faults are seen. Let's turn the microscope and look at ourselves also, no? Because we also need to be judged. So, the question is now, is Israel so much better than the other countries? Just like, are we better than other people? And the answer is definitely no. We think yes, but the answer is no, they are not. The only difference is that God has a purpose for Israel, just as God has a purpose for you and me. And that is the reason why, when we are driven by purpose, when we are driven by purpose, we love somebody and we never stop. Yeah, when you have a goal, you never stop. No matter how many times you fall, you will carry on. No matter how many times you are rejected, you will carry on. And we see the same thing so beautifully in today's reading of Isaiah chapter 48. Now, Isaiah chapter 48 almost seems to be, if you read it very carefully, the whole chapter, like a sermon that Isaiah is giving to whom? To the people of Israel who were in exile in Babylon. It seems like they were worshipping in a synagogue on a day of what must have been repentance. And on that occasion, Isaiah is talking to them in chapter 48. And these verses are very confrontational against the gods of the other nations. God is literally telling those people, I will deal with you and I will deal with your gods. But the Lord here is not only talking to the heathen nations, He's also talking directly to the Israelites. And God is also talking today to us. Not only to them, but also to us. They should know better, yeah? The people of Israel should have known better than to constantly worship other gods. So you can very clearly see, as I said at the start of this Mass, that God's children are stubborn. No? All of us are God's children. Are we stubborn? Yes. We are very stubborn. That is the reason why we fall into sin again and again and again. So though all of them were not guilty, the whole community, you notice today in the first reading, they are judged as a community. Let me give you an example. If you are a teacher and you get into class and three of people are making halla gulla in class, what do? You don't know which one was making the mischief. No, what does the teacher do? Whole class is punished. Yeah, you'll say, it's not my fault. But there are things that we do as a community, and therefore we have to take a responsibility as a community. Yeah, we can't say, this is not my fault, why are you punishing me, Father? No. If I know somebody else is doing something wrong, it is our duty to correct them. Otherwise, the whole punishment belongs to all of us. St. Paul says this so often, calls on us to correct one another. So many still, if you see among the people of Israel, many stood firm against Yahweh. They continued to worship these idols that they had started worshipping in Babylon. They do not respond to God under any circumstance, no matter what God says. And of the rest of the people of Israel, there were a few that truly worshipped God, while others were simply going through the motions of worshipping, you know, as we do sometimes in church. Nowadays, when we come to church, I look at your faces, all of you all, there's so much of joy. Huh? Because why? There was no opportunity. But now that you come to church, yeah. But otherwise, what was happening in the past? Sunday, the children also, everybody's doing this. So you can see that very often our worship, like the people of Israel, their outward expressions of faith were very hollow. It was very untruthful. Okay, no? Quickly. So I heard this child say, Hail Mary, full of grapes, the Lord is with you. Huh? So they didn't even realize what they were saying, no? Just for the sake of saying. Finish quickly. Like the people of Israel. Look at them. Their worship was external. So while the people call God, they invoke God's name, they seem to have a personal agenda. They are only calling God because when they need God. Huh? An outcome they were looking for, which they wanted to claim, that they want to show that they are God's people, but by their behavior, they were no different from those who did not even call on God's name. And this is what God is saying. Look at your behavior. So there should have been some evidence of salvation, but somehow the message does not match the manner. The message, yeah, supposing tomorrow I preach the message of love, but my manner is not that of love, then you'll say, Father, your message does not match the manner. And very often with faith and God, our manner does not match our message. We say we are Christians, but what part of our behavior is Christian? Bolte hum Christian hai. Lekin agar hum kisi ke unke bartav dekhe ya their behavior dekhe, to hume kya lagta hai? Ye sachmuch Christi hai kya? Aisa nahi lagte. Aur Prabhu hume kya kehte? Judna chahiye dono. Taki jab log hume dekhe, to log kya kahe? Sachmuch ye Christi hai. Inke swabhav mein, inke bolne mein, whatever we say must match. This is very important. So the fruit of our lives and also the people's lives in Israel, very often outside the sanctuary is nothing like the pretense of godliness that we have inside the sanctuary. Outside we are shaitan. Inside we are? Or nahi, the church mein hum kaitan hai. Bahar hum shaitan ban jate. Our swabhav, hamari swabhav bhi, everything changes. Badal jati. Kyun? And God says, the Lord makes it very clear, He can neither be deceived nor, He says, I can tolerate this hypocrisy. We heard it today in verse 4 and 8. God says, you can't be two types of people. One person in church and another person outside church. You have to be the same. The same person. Yeah? I remember one husband telling me, he said, Father, my wife is in church the whole day. You all think she's Mother Mary. When she comes home, she becomes the devil. Yeah? So, the behavior and the manner does not match at all. The words and the manner doesn't match. The two, God wants us to be consistent. Now, they're not going to be 100% consistent. Huh? But at least try. Huh? At least try to be consistent. So, even the best teacher, if you notice today, in today's first reading, even the best teacher fails. Why? Because the pupils are unwilling to learn. And God today says, I'm teaching you. I teach you. You heard the words? God says, I am teaching you. And he's really lamenting that, you know, in spite of he being our teacher, we don't want to learn. Look at verse 18. You'll see God saying that. He was the teacher who taught the Israelites for their own good. He says that in verse 17. I am teaching you. In fact, some translation says, I am teaching you so that you may profit. Profit means not make money, but that you may get better. I want to teach you. He says, I am the one who wants to lead you where you ought to go. And yet, we realize they paid no attention to God's commandments. We see this in verse 18. They didn't pay attention to God's. So the tragedy of Israel could easily have been avoided. They didn't have to go into exile. But the prophet today reminds Israel that all of her past history was one unending tragedy of squandered opportunities. God says, I've given you chance after chance after chance. What have you done? As God gives us. Chance after chance. One unending list of squandered opportunities. Squandered opportunity means God gives us that chance and what do? We say, chalo. Tomorrow I'll get up na. Tomorrow also I'll live na. Tomorrow I'll go to church na. Why go today? And what happens tomorrow? So this, of course, therefore places the responsibility of Israel's tragic state on God. Is God responsible for Israel's situation in exile? No. Who's responsible? Israel is responsible. Is God responsible for the mistakes we make? No. We are responsible. So contrary to popular opinion, and people always say this, no? There is no point in dwelling on the past. You'll say, Father, why are we talking about the past of Israel? So contrary to dwelling on that past, we are taken to the past. Why is God taking us today to the past? To contemplate what could have been or what is as a result of the choices that I make. The reason for this, of going to the past, is to learn how to go forward. We have to learn from our mistakes of the past. We have to. We can't say, why are we going to the past? Why is God digging up our past? God is not digging up our past. He is reminding us so that we learn. Sure, things should have been different in our lives. But has it changed now? So too often we tend to look at what could have been and the ground lost because what we failed to be. And God does not pretend that, you know, our past did not happen. No, He acknowledges. He wants us also to acknowledge. But the way forward is to face the past. To face our mistakes of the past. Not to hide behind them. God wants us to look at our mistakes in the past. The psalmist says so beautifully, my sin is ever before me. Why is the sin ever before you? Not to taunt you. Your sin is not before you to say, she, shame on you. No, to remind you not to make that same mistake again. To remind you. When you remember, in the Bible we read, Lord, forgive me for the sins of my youth. What we have done foolishly as young people, as we grow older, we said, I wish I never did that. As young people, we make a lot of mistakes. So God is not digging up our past to rub it into our face. No. He's doing that so that we remember our failings. We remember our sin. So history, my dear brothers and sisters, is a great teacher. And God also is a great teacher. Teaching from the past, God offers us hope by giving us a glimpse of what can be. So God really wants us to pick up the right road. He says, now that you made your mistake, Israel, now that you made your mistake, Brother Paolo, now that you made your mistake, Father Warner, now that you made your mistake, Xavier, or whoever's in church today, whatever you, now pick up the right road. Now don't walk again on the same road. The road What is the right road? The road that lines up with His great plans for us. So God says, I have made a road for you. Remember in Isaiah we did the other day? God says, I am preparing a highway for you. Not one gully. Not a gully. I am preparing a highway for you to come home. That's what He told the people of Israel. Why are you afraid? You will not be touched on that highway. Nobody will touch you. God doesn't say, patli gully se chalo. Sharam aane chahiye aapko. Aisa kehte Bhagwan. Agar aap wapis aa rahe ho, to patli gully pakad ke. Nahin. Maine aapke liye bada highway bana diya. And highways are expensive. So God wants us to line up on His great road that He has for us. And He can see what's on all the roads. He can see what's on all the roads out there. He can see which one is best for us. And He wants us to know that. Today Jesus is saying to us in the season of Advent, come back home. Come back home.